थिंग कि फैमिली ओन बिजनेस इंडिया में, बिकॉज इंडिया में जो फैमिली सिस्टम है, जो बॉन्डिंग है, जो अभी तक के आप अगर बिग हाउसेस को देखेंगे, टाटास, बिरलास, गोयनकास, बजाज, इमामी ग्रुप, ऑल ग्रुप्स आर गवर्न बाय फैमिली. तो फैमिली में, फैमिली बिजनेस में जो फाउंडर्स कंट्रोल की जो पोजीशन आती है, जो हमारा टॉपिक है फाउंडर्स कंट्रोल एंड सक्सेशन प्लानिंग, तो सक्सेशन प्लानिंग की ज़रूरत आज की डेट में क्यों ज़्यादा महसूस हो रही है, क्योंकि अब थर्ड जनरेशन पिक्चर में आ गई है और जो फाउंडर है, हमें फाउंडर के रोल को समझना होगा. हम ग्लोबली अगर हम बात करें कि बाहर जो कंट्रीज़ हैं वहाँ पे वो ऑल आर मैक्सिमम आर प्रोफेशनली मैनेज कंपनी, ओके, बट इन इंडिया वी हैव टू लाइन अप प्रोफेशन एज वेल एज आवर फैमिली वैल्यूज. वी हैव टू ब्रिज द गैप ऑफ वी हैव टू इनकॉर्पोरेट प्रोफेशनलिज्म इन आवर बिजनेस टू ग्रो मोर इन फैमिली बिजनेस.
Great, ma'am. Vikas sir, your view on the same. Ma'am have rightly corrected, rightly said most of the business houses which are doing very well and top level are managed by or more family oriented business in India when it compared to other developed countries like the US. So we want Vikas sir, your view on the same.
So you all, you know, I'm a lawyer and mostly a devil's advocate. So I'll always give you the other side.
Sure,
I'm used to arguing on the other side, whatever you may tell me.
We'll be very happy to know, because every coin has two sides, so we'll be very happy.
Well, unless that is there, we'll not, you know, be able to.
Sure, sir.
So first, I think this is a complete myth that USA companies are more professional. Let's first define what we are talking of in a founder's control and a professionally. There's a slight overlap. When we talk of family-owned businesses, we're normally talking of it's one person or a family or a group of close-knit people who control those businesses. So even within USA, the original assumption was this. But when they ended up doing their data, they figured out that even in the USA, close to 90% businesses are family-owned and family-run, which is somewhat similar across the world. India, it will be even slightly higher. Now, there is a lot of debate on this, that what is family controlled, because whether if you own 51%, it is family controlled, or sometimes even if you hold 25% of the stock, it's still you have the controlling stake. Sometimes it is 90%. Just to take an example out of the leaf, Microsoft. It's one man owned. It's family owned. Professional management and ownership are two different things. So even if you are family owned, you may, that is where the control lies. You may get in professional help to advise you, to take decision making. So that's the fundamental difference. So family owned businesses have always been there and likely to remain. The better answer would come in from people who understand human psychology a little better, because we tend to be more, and there are a lot of theories on it and a lot of studies that have gone into it. So I don't see much of a difference in the structure. The other thing is that in terms of the evolutionary curve of businesses, I think US is slightly ahead of us. So therein, even the founders themselves are professionally qualified.
Agreed.
Or they are more open to take external help. But that's, I think, fast coming in India as well. And that is why a whole lot of opportunities will open up for professionals and people like you coming out of professional colleges. So I think that is still, I don't think there's much of a difference in terms of control. But how you manage the succession and how you manage dissent and how you manage external help is where the difference lies. And therein, I think the issues are fairly similar at both, or even other countries. You may take Japan, for that matter, you may take Europe. Some of the biggest corporations across, I mean, if you take European countries, if you take Italy, Spain, France, Germany, and England, they are, in fact, as closely knit held as India, if not more. They are the family structures. If you talk any big company in Europe, you'll find them a family structure, whether it is Fiat or whether it is Benz or any of those. So I think the structure is not so much of a difference. It's how we take external help.
Right. Absolutely agreed with what you said. But the only question by many of the authors or many of the people who feel, in case of family controlled, or the companies which are controlled by founders, to some extent or to a lot of extent, there's a question on the corporate governance. The absolute delegation of power is not there, or the companies at some instance does not have been professionally managed at that level that it could be. So I would like Mr. Madan sir to please narrate what exactly happened in Tata Group, why Ratan Tata had to step in after being appointed his successor as Mr. Cyrus Mistry, and he has to one day step in and he has to remove, called for an extraordinary general meeting and has to remove Cyrus Mistry from the post of the chairman. So I would like Mr. Madan sir to please narrate and tell us what was the reason. Was it a bad successor? Was it a improper succession planning? Or was it a founder control which insisted him to do this action?
Also, let me share with you that Mr. Cyrus Mistry is a close relative of Mr. Ratan Tata. He is not from outside, because he is a brother-in-law of co-brother of Mr. Ratan Tata, Mr. Newell Tata's co.
Even a one of the main shareholders also.
Yes, one of the major shareholders. That also, since I think 1960s, they have been holding this stake in the company. So when in 2012, Mr. Ratan Tata retired, actually that's also again a big story in itself. And he was supposed to retire in, I think, 2005. Then the age was increased. Then his term was extended up to 2012. 2012, he turned 75. Then the change of guard, the chairmanship of Tata Group, particularly Tata Sons, was given to Mr. Cyrus Mistry. But during the gap of 4 years, the relations between the two, they were not good. There were a number of allegations by the Cyrus Mistry Group. If you read this judgment of NCLT Mumbai bench, which was pronounced in first week of July 2018, last month only, it is 368 pages judgment on this one particular aspect, whether Mr. Ratan Tata was acting against the interest of number one, Cyrus Mistry and the group of companies, and number two, against the public interest. You know, so much of allegations have been leveled against Mr. Ratan Tata that there was some, the information was being passed on to some other people outside, some other outside entities were being given benefit. Then whole lot of mismanagement allegations regarding this nano car, regarding this Tata Docomo, regarding this Air Asia, regarding of giving some benefits to some Sterling group of companies and all that. So many allegations were leveled against Mr. Ratan Tata. And the beauty of this judgment is, if you read the first paragraph itself very much denotes that the judge who passed this judgment was absolutely in favor of Mr. Ratan Tata. Because the very first sentence says that Tata is providing us how to season our food with Tata salt. And now this Tata salt also requires seasoning. And in various paragraphs, he has written out of blue, I tell you, so many things favoring Mr. Ratan Tata, which clearly indicates, yes, what are going to be the last concluding paragraphs. But so many allegations have been leveled by Mr. Cyrus Mistry against Mr. Ratan Tata and other directors also on the board of Tata Sons. But see how the courts have behaved in this case. This petition was filed under Section 241-242 of the Companies Act 2013. When the petition was filed before Mumbai bench, you know, whenever you file a petition, other party has to file a reply. But Mr. Tata didn't file the reply. He challenged the maintainability of this application. He said this petition is not maintainable, because as per the provisions, the persons who are filing the application, by filing the petition, they must hold at least 10% capital in the company. And Mr. Ratan Tata says they hold only 2.5% capital in the company, while Mr. Mistry says we hold 18.5% capital in the company. Now can you believe it? Can't there be so much of difference, 2.5% and 18.5%? But when the law was interpreted, Mr. Mistry says we hold 18.5% equity shares in the equity capital of the company. And Mr. Tata says, do you hold 2.5% shares in the entire capital of the company?
And as per law, you have to count the entire capital, means equity capital as well as preference share capital. So if you count the both, then you are not holding 2%. You are not holding more than 10%. Anyway, they filed a petition. They challenged the maintainability. NCLT bench says sorry. Application not maintainable. Dismissed. Matter went to NCLT Delhi. NCLT Appellate Tribunal. NCLT says sorry. Appeal dismissed. We are not ready to hear you. Matter comes back again to NCLT Mumbai. Now this time Cyrus Mistry files an exemption application. That though we do not hold 10%, but still under section 244, NCLT may grant us exemption and our application may be accepted. NCLT Mumbai bench again says sorry, no exemption granted. Now they file a petition before NCLT, an appeal. Now this time NCLT comes to their rescue and allow the appeal. Okay, now please go ahead. And now they direct, yes, okay. Matter remanded back to NCLT Mumbai. Now they will hear the case. Now matter comes before NCLT Mumbai bench. Cyrus Mistry again files another application before NCLT Principal's Bench Delhi that we are not comfortable with NCLT Mumbai bench. Because already earlier they have dismissed our two applications. We don't feel comfortable with that. But NCLT Principal bench, certainly they passed the remarks against Cyrus Mistry, imposed penalty also. And after that, a matter has gone, went back to NCLT Mumbai. And after a series of hearings, I tell you, I think more than 100 lawyers would have appeared from both sides. All top-notch lawyers from India, all senior advocates from Delhi and Mumbai and other parts of the country were there. But again, the allegations